nowadays, we've all got a favourite coffee.
One shot, flat white.
Mocha. Americano.
Cappuccino.
Since the 1990s, when branded coffee bars first hit the UK, we've embraced their caffeinated delights.
We can't get away from the fact that caffeine is an addictive product. It's something that we crave on a daily basis.
They have lured us away from our traditional haunts and changed the way we socialise.
Coffee shops created more places for people to stop, take time to snack, use their laptops and computers, and the pub wasn't always a fashionable place to be.
Three brands dominate the fight for the coffee pound.
We have to have great product, great stores in great locations, because if we don't, there'll be someone else that will.
I don't think Starbucks are at all frightened of us. We're a microscopic blip on their proverbial posterior.
We didn't look at Costa or Starbucks and try to mimic them at all. And for better or for worse, we kind of marched to our own drum.
But not everyone is head over heels about the boom in big-name coffee shops.
The big corporates control everything. It's almost the Big Brother scenario.
And one company in particular has got itself into very hot water over tax.
I'm not going to buy Starbucks coffee tomorrow. I think everybody should go and buy Costa.
This is the inside story of the branded coffee shop world, where coffee making is an exotic art, where pricing is an exact science.
If you really want the cheaper deal, if you really know what you're doing, you can pay less.
And where the coffee shop hotshots are raking in millions from our love affair with coffee. At Starbucks in Collington Road in Edinburgh, the baristas Ross, Jason and Louise have an early start. Even at this hour, there's a steady stream of bleary-eyed locals.
People tend to order lattes, cappuccinos, the stronger sort of drinks with more espresso just to sort of boost their day.
Up next, we've got a brandy latte for James.
Starbucks has 750 stores in the UK and over 20,000 more around the world. Last year, its international takings hit a mammoth $14.8 billion.
Got the Ethiopia espresso on that one as well, yeah.
But Starbucks is keen to stress that it cares about the personal touch.
We chose Collington Road because it's a great opportunity to work within a really good local community. They serve so many regular customers that just come in, and that's really great because they really are a part of that local community.
Usually every morning we can at least tell a good few people exactly by name. We'll know what they're up to, we know what they've been up to the weekend, and that's so good. We know all our customers really well.
Oh, happy birthday.
Thank you very much.
Cheers.
Starbucks is not the only show in town. More than 150 coffee shops grace Edinburgh's streets. But here, as in most places up and down the UK, Costa Coffee, Cafe Nero and Starbucks are the main attraction. They each seem to have what it takes to pull us in.
Customers like being in places that serve good coffee, where you can get your Wi-Fi, you can have your meetings and you can catch up on a bit of work, and in a rather cool and, you know, maybe, you know, happy and friendly ambience.
Last year, we handed over £6.2 billion to UK coffee houses, an increase of £400 million on the previous year. Retail sales grew by 2.6% last year, but branded coffee sales went up nearly four times as much. The average coffee shop customer spends over £450 a year on their habit. And the annual bill for a really enthusiastic drinker can be up to £2,000.
On a two coffee day, that's a fiver, easily. So that's, what, 35 quid a week? That's 140 a month. Look at me doing the maths. So we're looking at a grand and a half, two grand a year. And that's quite a lot of money. I don't regret it for a moment.
With so many big spenders amongst us, there is plenty of money to be made. Here's how the margins shake down. Take a regular cappuccino. The raw materials, the milk, water, and of course the coffee, cost about 15p. The cup and napkin cost another 15 pence or so. Then there's staffing, electricity, the shops themselves, and of course Wi-Fi and sofas. Those fixed costs add about another £1.20. Plus, there's about 45p of VAT. The average price of a regular cappuccino is around £2.30, so the stores are making a comfortable profit of around 35 pence per cup. Not surprisingly, competition for the coffee pound is intense, especially between Starbucks and Costa. Costa may not rival Starbucks' status as a vast global enterprise, but this successful British company is top of the pile in the UK.
Costa has been by far and away the most successful player in the market. With now 1,700 outlets across the country, it's growing at about 150 to 200 stores a year, which is phenomenal success.
Almost all of the coffee Costa brews comes from its roastery in Lambeth, South London. 9,000 tonnes of raw coffee beans are processed here every year. This is the domain of Gennaro Pelliccia, Costa's chief coffee taster.
Once the coffee comes into the factory, depending on which origin we need at that moment in time, coffee will come in, it gets split open, and it goes straight up into our holding silo, where we have all the different origins.
It's Gennaro's job to make sure the different types of raw coffee beans are blended and roasted to make a standard Costa flavour.
Each individual silo will open up, one after the other, first Brazilian and then Colombian and then some Vietnamese, depending on, you know, what the composition is today. That coffee is then sent upstairs to one of the two roasters. Whilst the coffee's in the roaster, it turns from the green colour that we've seen to that brown colour.
Costa Coffee's roastery is a very modern facility, but the history of the company goes back to a time when decent coffee was pretty hard to track down.
Ah, that's better. Never felt more like a cup of tea in my life.
Not for nothing do we consider ourselves a nation of tea drinkers. In the post-war years, Britain's tea consumption was 50 times that of coffee, and tea houses adorned our metropolitan centres. There were coffee bars, but they were the preserve of Italian expats.
Well, I was around in the 50s, but very, very young. I again, from my mother, who was operating as a restaurateur in Soho, there were just pockets of Italian immigrants that wanted to bring that culture into the UK.
Now, I like my coffee and I like my brew, but each has its own little job to do.
These Italian espresso bars in stylish Soho drew a new audience to coffee. They became bohemian hangouts for artists and beatniks.
You prefer a coffee, I feel?
Well, truthfully speaking, I do, yes.
Are you an abstract artist, may I ask?
No, not yet.
I'm glad to hear that. I'm very glad to hear that.
It was about the coffee bar and the music scene around the coffee bar. So I think it was hip, to take a word from the time, fashionable, and not so much about the quality of the coffee that was there. And that's why it never expanded and stood pretty still like that for about 20 years.
Enter two Italian brothers with a hankering for coffee.
Costa was founded in about 1971 by two brothers, Sergio and Bruno Costa, who were Italian immigrants who came over to the UK, couldn't find the taste of home here, so decided that they would set themselves up as a roasting and wholesale business.
At one point, all the hotels in Park Lane were serving Costa coffee. It became a very, very popular, very, very successful business.
But the Costa brothers wanted a bigger piece of the coffee action. They started to open their own cafes.
Good to see you. Been shopping?
Coffee?
The middle classes, though, were not interested in Italian-style coffee.
The special blend and roast.
Precisely.
That gives you that richer, smoother Nescafé taste.
By exactly. Now, Brits were infatuated with a totally different type of drink. In the 80s, the UK was the biggest market for instant coffee in the world.
Make sure you're serving coffee at its best.
Excuse me, I'd like a coffee, please.
Cappuccino, espresso.
Cappuccino.
Cappuccino.
We had heard of exotic Italian coffees, but as the Not the 9 o'clock News team showed in 1982, we definitely didn't take them seriously.
Just bring you back to story. This is early sort of 1979, 1980. So we're in Ponties. We've introduced espresso machines behind the bar. We're in the middle of Covent Garden. Loads of construction work going on. I'm behind the counter early morning. The guy's been sent from the building site to come in to order the coffees for the guys on the site. He's seen the machine. It's stamped in. He said, "Can I have 5 Desperados, please?" So I said, "Certainly, sir." And gave him 5 cappuccinos. He was absolutely delighted, but I just had this vision that he would be going back to the building site and saying, "I've got the Desperados, boys."
Across the pond, things were not much better, but coffee was about to get a massive makeover. Seattle in the 1980s and 90s was the tech capital of the world, the home of Microsoft, Nintendo, Amazon and Boeing. And it was the birthplace of the grunge alternative rock scene, propelling bands like Nirvana onto the international stage. Into this hotbed of counterculture and innovation burst the biggest thing to hit coffee since the espresso machine. It came in the form of Howard Schultz, the man who would become the godfather of modern coffee shops, the man who made Starbucks.
The in-house design center. In terms of all the creative ideas, all everything you see in the packaging that ultimately ends up in the stores.
When Schultz joined Starbucks in 1982, the company only sold beans, not cups of coffee. It was a trip he took to Italy that same year that changed coffee culture forever.
As he's walking along these streets in Milan, he's noticing just the culture of these Italian coffee bars. And not so much the coffee as the community that they're creating and the buzz that all hours of the day you've got people coming in and out of these shops, you know, standing, having their morning or afternoon espresso and having great, very animated conversation in streets of Milan. And he falls in love with this idea.
I race back from Italy with this wonder in my eye about recreating the Italian coffee bar in my own image and bringing it to America.
So convinced was he that Schultz took over the company and he opened his first Starbucks cafe in 1987.
In the very beginnings at Pike Place in Seattle where they began, they were a very sort of homemade, homespun business, and that was the appeal.
Pearl caramel macchiato, double.
Schultz shrewdly realized that Americans would not take to the short, bitter espressos favored by Italians, so he invented a new kind of coffee for his coffee houses.
If you think about the battle for the American coffee market, it was to try and get the younger generation away from soft drinks, Pepsi and Coke, introduce them to coffee. So here we have a drink that's got a caffeine kick, but it's bitter. Let's put a syrup in, let's make it milkier. So now we've got the caffeine kick, we've got the sugar content, and that was driven by the Americans.
Almost overnight, frankly, in a city that never heard of a cappuccino or a latte, it just goes wild. You've got queues out the door, and suddenly people in Seattle are drinking cappuccinos. That was the start of what was going to be a very big movement.
Pretty soon, Starbucks cafes were opening on every street corner. Schultz wanted his stores to provide a unique new environment, a third place.
The third place was really that place in people's lives that was somewhere between work and home, giving people a place to come together, giving people a reason to come together, and facilitating community through something as simple as a cup of coffee.
It was such an original idea to actually incorporate sort of soft furnishings, the things that we take for granted today, but sofas, bookcases, allowing consumers to feel like they're in their own homes. That was Howard Short's moment of genius.
The model of the cafe as the third place has been adopted by all the successful brands. If you look carefully, you will see that all coffee shops are planned out with precision.
In this store, there's about four different zones. But at the front of the store, you'll see there's some seating right by the windows. The customers can enjoy the view outside, but also, as important, other customers can see there are people in there. This is a great place to be. There are other customers I'm going to go in and join. Behind me over my shoulder, there's perch seating. This is very reminiscent of the traditional espresso houses in Italy, where you have your espresso, you stand, you perch, you drink it, and you go. We have big community tables where customers can come and sit, either as groups or individually, working on their laptops, reading, whatever. And then we have softer seating. It's a little bit more intimate.
Back in 1990s America, the third place became part of the zeitgeist. American sitcoms like Friends cast the coffee shop in a central role as a stylish home from home.
5, 96, 97. See, I told you. Less than 100 steps from our place to here.
You got way too much free time, man.
When Friends first aired in the UK, lounging on sofas in a cafe with your nearest and dearest seemed like an exotic new concept.
Happy birthday, pal.
We love you, man.
In Britain, we already had a centuries-old venue for meeting friends and socialising, a place that formed the essential backdrop of British sitcoms like Only Fools and Horses. The local boozer.
All right, Rodney, how'd you get on at Hampton Court?
I'm going to talk.
Well, what happened?
Cassandra gave him the elbow in the maze.
Oh, that sounds painful.
While Del Boy and Uncle Albert were sympathising with Rodney down the nag's head, all was not well in the pub world. Britain's established brewers had become so successful that the government decided it was time to loosen their monopolistic grip.
Britain's pubs could be in for big changes after a report today by the Monopolies Commission criticising the breweries. The commission says beer is too expensive and the breweries own too many pubs.
One brewer, Whitbread, was forced to dispose of almost a third of its 6,000 pubs. The top brass decided Whitbread had to diversify, and it identified female spending power as a huge emerging market.
Women have literally come out of the home. Now, what that's meant, of course, is that they've had their own income, their own wherewithal, their own tastes, and they weren't just going to be satisfied with having a baby sham down the pub now and again with their husbands.
Whitbread wanted to appeal to all these new female spenders, and it found the answer quite by accident.
On a trip to Canada in 1993, I visited what was probably the first Starbucks outside of the United States in downtown Vancouver, and was interested, but didn't think very much more of it. But 7 or 8 months later, going through the same intersection, I was absolutely amazed to see on the opposite corner of the intersection another Starbucks. And both Starbucks were trading well. It was a bit like a light bulb going on.
Whitbread's coffee light bulb had not lit up quickly enough to satisfy two American expats who found themselves stranded in London in the 90s, longing for a decent cup of coffee.
The very first morning Ali was in London, she walked me to work. We walked across Hyde Park and we stopped at this little Italian cafe because she wanted to get a coffee.
Scott and Ali Svensson had come to London from Seattle, where they had been Starbucks devotees.
I was trying to explain to her that the coffee experience was going to be different from what she had just come from.
The coffee offering in Britain in the 1990s was abysmal. I mean, it was absolutely
absolutely no reason for anyone to drink it. It didn't taste very nice, it didn't smell very nice, it didn't look very nice. Why would anyone drink that gloopy mess?
Desperate for a proper latte, the Svensons decided that it was up to them to change the face of British coffee. They set up their own coffee bar and they called it the Seattle Coffee Company.
We opened in April, but it worked in about 5 minutes.
We tinkered with that through that very hot summer, and at the end of that year, we opened two more in December.
At precisely the same time, Whitbread found the ideal way to enter the coffee market.
We thought briefly about perhaps approaching Starbucks for the UK franchise, but our main thrust was to find if there was an acquisition that we could make of a small company and drive forward from there. And Costa ticked virtually all of our boxes.
People were just starting to get the idea that it might be part of their daily routine and what they did. So it was, you could argue, incredibly prescient or a little bit lucky as well. But equally, it was the start of an enormous growth industry in the UK.
In the 1990s coffee gold rush, Costa Coffee and the Seattle Coffee Company were joined by Coffee Republic, Cafe Nero, and a host of wannabe coffee brands.
Without a shadow of a doubt, we were in it for the logo and the paper cups early days. We didn't really care or know about the coffee, but we thought it looked great. I certainly was part of that. I thought I looked so cool.
The coffee competition was about to get a lot more fierce. By now, Howard Schultz had conquered America, and he wanted to go global.
I want to be able to be one of those rare companies that is ubiquitous.
Schultz had 1,600 stores in the US, and he had his eye on Britain. In 1998, he made the Svensons an offer it would have seemed rude to refuse.
It came down to Howard Schultz and I sitting in a restaurant in London and having a philosophical conversation and ultimately reaching across the table and shaking hands.
The Svensons walked away £50 million richer, and Starbucks had arrived in Britain. It's mid-morning at Costa's roastery and a tasting is underway. Gennaro and his team regularly take batches they are planning to use and sample them according to age-old tasting rituals. The slapping is not just for fun. It sprays the coffee all over the tasters' taste buds so they can profile each individual batch of beans.
Our job here is to maintain the consistency of our in-store mock Italian blend. We're using coffee from all over the world. We're using Colombian coffee, Costa Rican coffee, Ecuadorian coffee. Some of these origins, their harvests obviously are at different times. So at different times throughout the year, the coffee will perform slightly differently. The danger is, if we do not constantly check the coffee, not just at the end of the season, but throughout the season, we cannot guarantee the consistency in our stores. So that's why it's so important that we do it all the time.
Costa's flavour clearly plays well with us because it is Britain's number one coffee brand. It's especially popular with women aged 35 to 54. Last year, the company turned over £648 million in the UK.
I really like Costa Coffee because it's nice and spacious, so I can get the buggy in. I actually really like their coffee as well. It's quite mild, and I like to have their decaf coffee. I like to sit down and read the paper while Layla's asleep and just have half an hour for myself.
Starbucks is popular for its iced drinks and its American branding, and it's a favourite of young people. Its UK cash tills rang up £419 million last year.
I love the staff in here, they're always so friendly and so lovely.
Yeah, the food's really good here as well. They always make like a really good drink for you as well. So.
Nero has a strong Italian image, and it attracts a slightly more male audience. In 2013, Nero had UK takings of £215 million.
I've just had a routine for years where I've always wanted to have a coffee, reading my paper, you know, first thing in the morning before I literally hit the road. And for me personally, I like Nero's coffee.
Having a favourite brand of coffee shop would once have been unimaginable. But as the coffee shop phenomenon flourished in the 90s, so did our appreciation of good, strong coffee.
Tasting a stronger flavour is all about, for me, moving up the ladder of taste. And once you're up that rung on the ladder, it's almost impossible to go back.
I started drinking what I believe at the time was called a Why Bother, which was a skinny, decaffeinated cappuccino, no chocolate. So I started ordering that just to be part of the gang, to have the cup, largely. And at some point, I must have gone, what the hell, I'll have it caffeinated. And that was how my sort of addiction, fascination, obsession, love affair began.
It's almost like that legal drug that's hooked everybody. Once exposed, that's it for life.
And it's not just the coffee that we have become hooked on. The whole theatre of coffee making draws us in from the moment we walk in the door.
Hello. The way that we run our service is every barista engages with the customer and is an expert coffee maker. Therefore, the coffee machine has to be within their reach. They can't step more than one step over in order to make the coffee. We don't want to have the coffee machine at the front to be a barrier to you as the customer. We don't want to create an emotional block. We want to create an emotional freedom and engagement and ease. They want to stand and make the coffee and talk to you at the same time, and then they turn back. If they happen to ever turn their back, then we do make sure that people see that we have the best espresso this side of Milan.
This kind of rapport with chirpy baristas is a far cry from the British service culture of yesteryear.
Service is now a competitive advantage. And if you think about how the ante is absolutely being upped and the service standards have improved in the UK, coffee shops have definitely been an important part of that.
By the time the new millennium dawned, we had been seduced. We discovered that we could sit for hours nursing a single cup of coffee.
Coffee shops created more places for people to stop and to take time to snack, use their ever-growing laptops and computers at the time.
We even learned a whole new language just so we could put in our order.
One shot.
Flat white.
Chai tea latte.
Soya latte.
Espresso.
Mocha. Americano.
Cappuccino.
Chai latte.
A one shot decaf cappuccino.
Starbucks had brought to the UK a cornucopia of drinks that were already selling well in the US, but were unheard of over here.
Our number one drink is our skinny latte, and that remains pretty constant right through the year. At Christmas time, we have those really indulgent Christmas offerings that our customers love. But in the summertime, hopefully we'll get another great summer as we did last year. Ice drinks become a very important part, and our Frappuccino has now become really quite famous and something that our customers come in time and time for.
We lapped up Starbucks concoctions, so, not surprisingly, Starbucks-style drinks have also appeared on its competitors' menus.
If we see that something that's working, then, you know, our customers will be asking for it too. So clearly we would rather them come to us for that drink than anywhere else, so we give customers what they want, absolutely.
If somebody from 25 years ago walked into a modern cafe, they'd be completely bewildered by the range of drinks on offer, all the different foreign names, all the different sizes, all the different combinations, the skinny, the full fat, the soya, the syrups.
And once you've managed the difficult job of deciding which drink you want, there's one more hurdle to negotiate.
What size would you like?
If the drinks are confusing, then the cup sizes are a nightmare. So, on the off chance that you don't know your grandes from your primos, I present the Idiot's Guide to Coffee Sizing. At Cafe Nero, there are three no-nonsense sizes, the small, regular and grande. At Costa, you've got the primo, the medio and the massimo. And at Starbucks, there's the tall, grande and venti. And here's one more that you may not have heard of, the Starbucks short.
One of the interesting deals available at Starbucks is the secret cappuccino, the coffee that dare not speak its name. If you go into Starbucks, you'll see three sizes of drinks, the tall, the grande, the venti. You can also get a short. Now, the short is, of course, smaller than the tall, and it's cheaper. And the reason they don't advertise the existence of this cheaper drink is because they don't want to make it too easy to get that bargain. If you really want the cheaper deal, if you really know what you're doing, you can pay less.
Starbucks, of course, gives a slightly different reason for the absence of the short on the menu.
There are literally thousands of combinations of our drinks. You can have it tall, grande, skinny, with something, without something. We want to make sure that it's your drink. You want to have it in the way that you want to have it. There's just, frankly, not enough room to put every combination up on a menu board behind.
So why do the coffee shops have thousands of combinations? The answer is that a wide choice of products makes good business sense.
Wouldn't it be brilliant, from the point of view of the cafe, if there was a way to charge more to people who didn't mind paying more and to charge less to people who absolutely demanded the best possible deal? And it turns out there is a way to do this. You just offer this menu of choices where any customer who isn't price sensitive can order a sprinkling of marshmallows and a fancier combination and maybe an extra shot of espresso and an extra bit of syrup. And these things really don't cost a lot to provide. The margins on them are absolutely fantastic.
So how does it work? Well, remember the margin on a regular cappuccino? It was a decent 35 pence profit. Look what happens if you supersize your order. Say to a large cafe latte with a flavour and an extra topping. Now the raw materials cost a bit more at about 30p. The packaging and the fixed costs are roughly the same, and VAT has gone up to about 65 pence. So the costs have gone up a bit, but the price tag has soared to around £3.30, almost trebling the profit on each cup. Given all this coffee-powered cash flying around, you could be forgiven for thinking that setting up a coffee shop chain would be a license to print money. But you'd be wrong. As the noughties dawned, coffee drinking seemed to be deeply entrenched in the British lifestyle.
I got very excited back in 2003 when I saw the latte had become part of the consumer price index. And for me, that was a sign that this market was really here, that this branded coffee product was part of British lifestyle.
Despite this, none of the brands was turning a profit, because coffee shops only make money if they can control the fixed costs, like their rents. One company in particular was struggling. Coffee Republic had been the brainchild of brother and sister team Bobby and Sahar Hashemi. They had grown their business quickly since 1995, taking on locations with astronomical rents where footfall would be high. But their brand was not strong enough to pull in the punters.
They were a brand that was wanting to be a Starbucks, but they didn't have the same brand pull of Starbucks. They didn't have the financial covenants. They didn't have the financial clout of Starbucks. So they're going head-to-head with Starbucks on the same premises and actually perhaps a bit of hubris, paying above and beyond what they should have paid.
Rents matter because a third of us are more likely to choose a coffee bar based on its convenience than any other factor, meaning landlords can charge a fortune for prime sites.
In the land grab, we ended up acquiring sites that, because of the competition or because of the high rents, have not been profitable for us.
Coffee Republic was eventually forced into administration. Bobby Hashemi stepped down, and today the company is a fraction of the size it once was. The UK coffee market had boiled down to three big brands. Starbucks out in front, with Costa and Nero bringing up the rear. But the landscape was about to change.
In the mid-2000s, Costa was a mediocre brand. It was a brand that was a bit of a lost. It was stuck in the middle, really. It was in no man's land. It wasn't. It didn't have the coffee credentials of Cafe Nero. It didn't have the sort of sexy brand image of Starbucks. The arrival of a new management team in 2007 was actually a pivotal moment in Costa's development. It really was the moment that they put the foot on the accelerator.
One of the new managers who put his pedal to the floor was marketing whiz Jim Slater. In 2008, he hatched a plan that would hit Starbucks where it would hurt.
There was a general perception amongst the public that all coffee was the same, and it clearly isn't. So we commissioned a blind taste test, and the results were stunning.
It was a robust and a well-certified study, and from that we felt confident enough to put advertising out that said 7 out of 10 coffee lovers prefer Costa.
When the ad campaign was first launched, Howard Schultz seemed undaunted.
We serve about 2 million customers a week here in the UK. We are the leader, and we will maintain our leadership position.
But Costa's adverts had gone for Starbucks' jugular.
We wanted to be fairly blatant, and lines like, "Sorry, Starbucks, the people have voted," were quite hard-hitting at the time, and they proved very effective.
Starbucks was unnerved and complained to the Advertising Standards Authority.
We thought they would complain, and that's why we had to make absolutely sure that the research was totally robust, perfectly legal, and would stand to any kind of challenge.
The ASA upheld Costa's claims despite Starbucks' contention that the blind test only used cappuccinos and that the test did not prove that Starbucks customers preferred Costa's coffee.
There was some level of challenge around, you know, the accuracy of it, but that was all upheld and was found to be true. And I guess beyond that, you should probably ask Starbucks.
They're very entitled to say what they say, and actually that's fine, because we've got to concentrate on what we do. We've got to concentrate on our customers and making our business the best it can be.
I don't think Starbucks are at all frightened of us. You know, we're a microscopic blip on their proverbial posterior.
As Starbucks and Costa Coffee were very publicly slugging it out for the number one spot in British coffee, their smaller and lower-profile cousin, Cafe Nero, was quietly building up a sizable empire of its own.
We didn't look at Costa or Starbucks and try to mimic them at all or do anything similar. And for better or for worse, we kind of marched to our own drum.
Gerry Ford launched Nero in London. But the stores are based on an Italian model.
Caffè Nero feels more like an authentic experience. You know, it feels more like a specialist. And that clearly spills into its food because it has a more specialised offer. It feels more like a quality premium food offer.
Food is important because coffee shops only really prosper if they can entice us to spend more by offering us mouth-watering goodies.
In the early days, food was relatively uninspiring in coffee shops. It was perhaps a dry, stale muffin or a piece of toast. If you're very lucky, you might have got a croissant. So it was very simple, very basic. Today's coffee shops have really increased their food offer.
The driving force is the core product of coffee and the craftsmanship and the quality that goes into that. But the food sort of complements that. We have 30% of our sales are in food, which is higher than either of the two other major brands and higher than most local independents.
At Cafe Nero on Peter Street in Manchester, the staff know lunchtime is always busy.
Make sure all the tables are clear, there's places for the customers to sit.
at HQ in London, Cafe Nero's Italian food consultant, Ursula Farigno, is holding a tasting session to give staff a real flavour of Italy. Ursula is employed by Cafe Nero to try to put that sought-after Italian stamp on its food.
The customer is becoming more and more discerning. I feel it's very important. You know, they can walk into a Cafe Nero and think, I am getting exceptional food, and it's just like Italy. I'd like to come in with a very ambitious range of food. Some of my ideas need to be tweaked, but they're all authentic, exploring new foods, new ideas.
Once Ursula's ambitions have been sufficiently tweaked, the challenge is to make sure they will work in the stores.
We do a lot of testing and trialing. It's important that we've applied sufficient rigour to the process. So we test it both within our own food team, within the wider Cafe Nero team, and with customers. If we have confidence in a product, we'll just say, you know, this is great, we love it, we think our customers will love it, and we put it out there.
Purists, though, might not regard every item as being in line with Ursula's quest for the authentic Italian experience.
Tell me about muffins.
We had a big debate about it. Do we serve that, which is slightly an American type of product? We don't have a lot of those, but if we're going to do some of them, we want to do them better than anybody else.
By the late noughties, the British coffee shops were all serving us decent food, decent coffee, and most of them were making decent money. But then the economy hit a bump in the road. Across the country, shops began closing down. Household budgets were squeezed. Belts were tightened. But UK consumers were not about to give up on their daily dose of coffee.
On the one hand, it's quite a luxury to spend £2.50 on a cup of coffee when you could make a cup of instant coffee at home. You don't need to spend that money. On the other hand, it's an affordable luxury.
I'm not remotely surprised that people kept drinking coffee through the recession, and I certainly did. And it did seem like an even more precious pleasure at that point.
In fact, the recession was a boon to coffee shops. Property prices and rents plummeted, allowing the brands to snap up new locations at bargain prices. Costa put on an impressive growth spurt, adding hundreds of sites in 2009 and 2010. By the end of the decade, Costa had achieved what might once have seemed impossible. For the first time in the UK, it had more stores, more customers, and higher takings than its giant rival, Starbucks. Although Costa don't like to overplay the achievement.
Yes, internally it was very exciting, and obviously we were happy to have done it, but ultimately you still have to stay focused on getting it right for the customer, and I think that's the driver. It wasn't about overtaking our competition.
Whether the race was important or not, Costa's expansion into the regions was proving to be a winning strategy. Opening stores in small towns is not always popular, as Costa discovered when it set its sights on a small shop in the Devon town of Totnes.
We'd found what we thought was a great location for us, and we, you know, set about our usual plans around opening, and then understood that there was some strong local feeling about us coming.
In this seemingly peaceful market town, Costa's plans had stirred up a hornet's nest. One of the local businessmen who declared war on Costa was independent cafe owner Martin Turner.
We're a town of only about 8,000 to 9,000 people, and we have
three or four independent butchers. There's a similar sort of amount of veg shops. There's many cafes here, but we feel that the cafes here are of a good quality. You can come here and see many different things, rather than it just being a stereotypical town.
It's a view shared by many, but our towns are beginning to look alarmingly alike.
You could be in a British high street and you look, and it'd be replicated 100 times over throughout the UK. Individual chains, local businesses, they bring individuality. They bring a little bit uniqueness to it, yeah. I personally would like to, if I went into one town, that I could find the local good coffee shop there, and the same when I moved on to the next town. I don't want to go and see the same brand there and the same brand there.
As feelings ran high in Totnes, Costa executives embarked on a fact-finding mission.
We went down and we talked to the MP and the mayor and the leader of the group that was that didn't want us to open.
When they said that they were coming down en masse and they wanted to meet, you know, myself and a few other people, it was okay. You know, this is our time almost. This is the time to be able to actually have our say and have an honest conversation with them.
The protesters declared that Costa would damage the essence of Totnes if they insisted on opening there.
We're a local company. We employ local, we shop local. The money stays local. And that was the really, really important thing, is when big corporates come in, the money just goes out of the town. The big corporates control everything. It's almost the Big Brother scenario.
Faced with such vigorous opposition, Costa threw in the towel.
We listened, and ultimately we decided that the best thing was to not open, because there was a real groundswell of opinion that said that they would rather stay with their independent coffee shops in that town, of which there were many, rather than have a Costa.
A few Totnes residents had fought the corporate machine of Costa, and they had won.
When we actually heard that they weren't coming in, it was a massive surprise. It was the first time they'd ever done that. So for us, it was a massive coup.
It's not all good news for Totnes, though. Apart from the odd pop-up shop, the proposed Costa site has lain empty for nearly 2 years. And whilst some people oppose coffee shops, others see it as a downright advantage when the brands come to town.
What's interesting now, as far as estate agents are concerned, then they like to sell the idea of there's going to be a Starbucks here, or there's going to be a Costa here, or indeed, actually, above all, there's going to be a Waitrose in the local community. This is a strong selling proposition as far as places and property, towns and city centres are concerned.
What about those small local independents in Totnes and across the country? Are they being squeezed out by the bullying power of the brands?
A brand, when it comes to a town or a high street, can impact an independent. Having said that, I think it's going to hurt the independents, which maybe have less of a quality offering to offer, and it won't impact independents who have quite a strong quality offering.
There is a lot of space for all of us, from Costa and also the independent artisans. As a whole, there are more independent artisan coffee shops in the UK than there are branded stores. So, yeah, there is a lot of space.
Well, the big brands would say that, wouldn't they? But the numbers don't lie. In fact, out of 16,500 coffee shops in the UK, only 5,500 of them belong to big brands. The rest are independents. Often, independents do well precisely because they are small and they do not have the spotlight of negative media coverage that exposes the dealings of bigger companies.
If a company, a brand, is doing well, if it's producing what people want, it's going to get bigger, and no one will complain about that. If it becomes complacent, lazy, not doing the right thing as far as their social responsibilities are concerned, people will stop voting for that brand, and they'll lose their place pretty quickly.
In recent years, the brands have been challenged over the issue of fair prices for farmers. As a result of consumer pressure, the branded coffee shops now buy their coffee almost exclusively from sustainable sources, paying up to 12% above the average world price for their raw coffee. Part of the reason they do this is because if one of them didn't, it would be easy for us to switch to a brand that did. One company has been affected by the power of consumer pressure more than any other. Starbucks has faced the animosity of anti-globalization rioters. It has been accused of mistreating its staff. It's even been put through the ringer for using too much water. Starbucks was in the news again in late 2012 when tax avoidance allegations hit the headlines.
Starbucks has been criticised over reports that it hasn't paid any corporation tax in the UK for the last 3 years.
Margaret Hodge, chair of the Public Accounts Committee, added fuel to the fire on the BBC's Newsnight.
It's not paying fair tax. Yes. I'm not going to buy Starbucks coffee tomorrow. I think everybody should go and buy Costa.
Some consumers did exactly what Margaret Hodge suggested and boycotted Starbucks.
You walked past Starbucks at that point when the tax story hit and they were empty largely. And it felt right. While I understand that as any corporation is inclined to get away with paying as little tax as they possibly can, they should. We should. We're all part of this. We need to pay tax, whoever we are.
Starbucks was forced to react. The company had not been paying corporation tax because it had been taking advantage of legal tax deductions. So technically, it wasn't making a profit in the UK. Belatedly, Starbucks has decided to waive some of those tax deductions. That means it will pay £20 million in tax over the next 2 years.
We decided that our customers didn't need to wait for us to become profitable for us to make a contribution to the Exchequer in the UK. And that's a decision we made. We did it because we listened to our customers. And I think we have a history. We have a 42-year history of doing the right thing. And I think we did the right thing. We're paying corporation tax today. And we feel very good about it.
By the time it was able to feel very good about its tax obligations, Starbucks customers had already flocked back. Costa had seen a spike in sales immediately after the news story broke, but the effect was short-lived.
As far as Starbucks was concerned, actually, it was a relatively small crisis. They had, they had their bottoms smacked. But fundamentally, if you've got a strong brand and a great offer that people want, people will come back and they'll come back quickly. And the reality is, people like going into Starbucks.
At Costa on Peter Street in Manchester, there's a brisk evening trade. Beth has worked for Costa for 5 years. She's an old hand on the late shift.
Evenings are just as busy as mornings. We usually have a lot of, like, shoppers leaving shops, coming here, chilling with all the big bags and stuff like that. People work quite late these days, and I think that after a nice, hard day at work, they do end up wanting a coffee.
In the evening, customers prefer milder drinks.
Usually a lot of hot chocolates, I think, and a lot of, like, milky coffees. So obviously they don't want something too strong in the evening because they want to be, like, up all night.
This branch of Costa, with its late closing time, is proving to be a hit with locals. But there is plenty of competition on this street for the coffee pound.
The success of the coffee pounds has been observed and admired by the broader food service outlets. So brands like Pret, like McDonald's, have actually seen the opportunity and said, I want a piece of that.
As other food outlets have improved the coffee they offer, it's meant that we now have more and more choice about where to get a decent cup of coffee. That's made life much more competitive for coffee shops.
It's a Darwinian world out there. You need to keep on improving your offer, improving your brands. If you do what customers want, if you go where they're going, you succeed. If you don't, if you're stuck in history, it doesn't work and you're way off.
That Darwinian world has forced Starbucks to face up to its image as a corporate leviathan. They're now trying to make their stores seem less corporate and more local.
Years ago, every Starbucks virtually looked the same. And we were getting loads of customer feedback saying, we love your products, We love your partners, our baristas, but frankly, the store's a bit outdated and a bit old-fashioned. So we've really listened to that, and over the course of the last couple of years, we've refurbished almost half their whole estate so that we can make sure that every store is unique and places where customers can really say, yeah, this is my third place, this is where I want to go. That's my Starbucks store.
While Starbucks is trying to make its cafes seem small and lovable, Costa is still expanding, and it's found a way to reach even more customers using the Costa Express vending machine.
Inside every single Costa Express machine, we use the same coffee as we use in our coffee shops. So I'm just ordering up my coffee here. So I'll go for a plain cappuccino.
Jim Slater and his team are about to launch a brand new Costa Express model, which takes vended coffee to a whole new level.
You can just hear the gentle buzz of a coffee shop in the background there, just to bring the sense of sound into play here. You can also smell the smell of artisanal bakery products, this little pain au chocolat. You can just smell wafting from the machine. Here again, just evoking a coffee shop and bringing those senses to life.
You can have the exact same ingredients, i.e. the freshly ground Mocha Italia coffee, extracted as an espresso using fresh milk to make the same cappuccino caffè latte americano that you have in a Costa store made by a barista.
Here's the finished coffee, a beautiful cappuccino. Lovely.
Can I get a flat white, please?
Yeah, of course, sir.
But if the coffee really is that good from Costa's vending machines, why do we need coffee shops and specially trained baristas at all?
When you come to a coffee shop, you're not just buying the coffee. That'll be the key driver, obviously. But actually, once you've wrapped the service and the environment around it as well, that's what really makes the difference.
And that seems to be the key for the coffee shops. It's not simply about the coffee. Just as Howard Schultz dreamed 25 years ago, coffee shops are as much about having somewhere to hang out as they are about decent cappuccinos. That's something the coffee shop brands are set to profit from as they roll out towards new frontiers around the world.
We're in the UK, we're in Ireland, we're in Poland, we're in Cyprus, we're in Turkey, and we're in the UAE.
We've got more than 300 stores in China now, more than 100 across the UAE, over 100 in Poland. So we're spreading out across the world.
Starbucks, meanwhile, is operating in 64 countries worldwide, and it is planning to continue to grow here in the UK.
There's a huge demand for better coffee and experiences here, maybe more so than anywhere else in the world, so we'll continue to invest here. And that means growing our store base, of course, but only in those places where we think there's a real need and we'll be welcomed.
For many of us, the spread of all coffee shops is welcomed because we are now officially a nation of coffee lovers.
I cannot bear being somewhere and not knowing where the next good latte is coming from. It's such a delight to get off a train or get out of a car and see a Starbucks or see a Nero or see a very good independent coffee shop. It's like a little beacon of civilization. You know things are basically going to be okay when you see that.
The Open University delves further into how these businesses continue to boom. Go to bbc.co.uk/businessboomers and follow the links to the Open University, where you can also take part in our online survey.
Et la jolie cloche ding dang dong, mais boum, quand notre cœur fait boum, tout avec lui dit boum, et c'est l'amour qui s'éveille. Boum, il chante loving bloom. Au rythme de ce boum qui redit boum à l'oreille.
Drinker can be up to £2,000.
On a two coffee day, that's a fiver, easily. So that's, what, 35 quid a week? That's 140 a month. Look at me doing the maths. So we're looking at a grand and a half, £2,000 a year. And that's quite a lot of money. I don't regret it for a moment.
With so many big spenders amongst us, there is plenty of money to be made. Here's how the margins shake down. Take a regular cappuccino. The raw materials, the milk, water, and of course the coffee, cost about 15p. The cup and napkin cost another 15 pence or so. Then there's staffing, electricity, the shops themselves, and of course Wi-Fi and sofas. Those fixed costs add about another £1.20. Plus, there's about 45p of VAT. The average price of a regular cappuccino is around £2.30, so the stores are making a comfortable profit of around 35 pence per cup. Not surprisingly, competition for the coffee pound is intense, especially between Starbucks and Costa. Costa may not rival Starbucks' status as a vast global enterprise, but this successful British company is top of the pile in the UK.
Costa has been by far and away the most successful player in the market. With now 1,700 outlets across the country, it's growing at about 150 to 200 stores a year, which is phenomenal success.
Almost all of the coffee Costa brews comes from its roastery in Lambeth, South London. 9,000 tonnes of raw coffee beans are processed here every year. This is the domain of Gennaro Pelliccia, Costa's chief coffee taster.
Once the coffee comes into the factory, depending on which origin we need at that moment in time, coffee will come in, it gets split open, and it goes straight up into our holding silo, where we have all the different origins.
It's Gennaro's job to make sure the different types of raw coffee beans are blended and roasted to make a standard Costa flavour.
Each individual silo will open up, one after the other, first Brazilian and then Colombian and then some Vietnamese, depending on, you know, what the composition is today. That coffee is then sent upstairs to one of the two roasters. Whilst the coffee's in the roaster, it turns from the green colour that we've seen to that brown colour.
Costa Coffee's roastery is a very modern facility, but the history of the company goes back to a time when decent coffee was pretty hard to track down.
Ah, that's better. Never felt more like a cup of tea in my life.
Not for nothing do we consider ourselves a nation of tea drinkers. In the post-war years, Britain's tea consumption was 50 times that of coffee, and tea houses adorned our metropolitan centres. There were coffee bars, but they were the preserve of Italian expats.
Well, I was around in the 50s, but very, very young. I came from my mother, who was operating as a restaurateur in Soho. There were just pockets of Italian immigrants that wanted to bring that culture into the UK.
Now, I like my coffee and I like my brew, but each has its own little job to do.
These Italian espresso bars in stylish Soho drew a new audience to coffee. They became bohemian hangouts for artists and beatniks.
You prefer a coffee, I feel?
Well, truthfully speaking, I do, yes.
Are you an abstract artist, may I ask?
No, not yet.
I'm glad to hear that. I'm very glad to hear that.
It was about the coffee bar and the music scene around the coffee bar. So I think it was hip, to take a word from the time, fashionable, and not so much about the quality of the coffee that was there. And that's what...
Hi, what would you like today?
Nowadays, we've all got a favourite coffee.
One shot, flat white.
Mocha, Americano.
Cappuccino.
Since the 1990s, when branded coffee bars first hit the UK, we've embraced their caffeinated delights.
We can't get away from the fact that caffeine is an addictive product. It's something that we crave on a daily basis.
They have lured us away from our traditional haunts and changed the way we socialise.
Coffee shops created more places for people to stop, take time to snack, use their laptops and computers, and the pub wasn't always a fashionable place to be.
Three brands dominate the fight for the coffee pound.
We have to have great product.
great stores in great locations. Because if we don't, there'll be someone else that will.
I don't think Starbucks are at all frightened of us. We're a microscopic blip on their proverbial posterior.
We didn't look at Costa or Starbucks and try to mimic them at all. And for better or for worse, we kind of marched to our own drum.
But not everyone is head over heels about the boom in big-name coffee shops.
The big corporates control everything. It's almost the Big Brother scenario.
And one company in particular has got itself into very hot water over tax.
I'm not going to buy Starbucks coffee tomorrow. I think everybody should go and buy Costa.
This is the inside story of the branded coffee shop world, where coffee making is an exotic art, where pricing is an exact science.
If you really want the cheaper deal, if you really know what you're doing, you can pay less.
And where the coffee shop hotshots are raking in millions from our love affair with coffee. At Starbucks in Collington Road in Edinburgh, the baristas Ross, Jason and Louise have an early start.
Why it never expanded and stood pretty still like that for about 20 years.
Enter two Italian brothers with a hankering for coffee.
Costa was founded in about 1971 by two brothers, Sergio and Bruno Costa. Who were Italian immigrants who came over to the UK, couldn't find the taste of home here, so decided that they would set themselves up as a roasting and wholesale business.
At one point, all the hotels in Park Lane were serving Costa coffee. It became a very, very popular, very, very successful business.
But the Costa brothers wanted a bigger piece of the coffee action. They started to open their own cafes.
Good to see you. Been shopping?
Coffee.
The middle classes, though, were not interested in Italian-style coffee.
With a special blend and roast.
Precisely.
It gives you that richer, smoother Nescafe taste.
Exactly. By now, Brits were infatuated with a totally different type of drink. In the 80s, the UK was the biggest market for instant coffee in the world.
Make sure you're serving coffee at its best.
Excuse me, I'd like a coffee, please.
Cappuccino, espresso.
Cappuccino.
Cappuccino.
We had heard of exotic Italian coffees. But as the Not the 9 o'clock News team showed in 1982, we definitely didn't take them seriously.
Just bringing back to story, this is early sort of 1979, 1980. So we're in Ponties, we've introduced espresso machines behind the bar. We're in the middle of Covent Garden, loads of construction work going on. I'm behind the counter early morning. The guy's been sent from the building site to come in to order the coffees for the guys on the site. He's seen the machine, it's stamped in.
Art. Even at this hour, there's a steady stream of bleary-eyed locals.
People tend to order lattes, cappuccinos, the stronger sort of drinks with more espresso just to sort of boost their day.
Up next, we've got a brandy latte for James.
Starbucks has 750 stores in the UK and over 20,000 more around the world. Last year, its international takings hit a mammoth $14.8 billion.
Got the Ethiopia espresso in that one as well, yeah.
Starbucks is keen to stress that it cares about the personal touch.
We chose Collington Road because it's a great opportunity to work within a really good local community. They serve so many regular customers that just come in, and that's really great because they really are a part of that local community.
Usually every morning we can at least tell a good few people exactly by name. We'll know what they're up to, we know what they've been up to the weekend, and that's it's good. We know all our customers really well.
Oh, happy birthday. Thank you
very much.
Cheers.
Starbucks is not the only show in town. More than 150 coffee shops grace Edinburgh's streets. But here, as in most places up and down the UK, Costa Coffee, Cafe Nero and Starbucks are the main attraction. They each seem to have what it takes to pull us in.
Customers like being in places that serve good coffee, where you can get your Wi-Fi, you can have your meetings and you can catch up on a bit of work, and in a rather cool and, you know, maybe, you know, happy and friendly ambience.
Last year, we handed over £6.2 billion to UK coffee houses, an increase of £400 million on the previous year. Retail sales grew by 2.6% last year, but branded coffee sales went up nearly four times as much. The average coffee shop customer spends over £450 a year on their habit. And the annual bill for a really enthusiastic